telling someone I had an opportunity to work with a coach for public speaking a while ago. And one of the techniques they told me is to center yourself by telling yourself, I like it here. And this time, like, this is really true. This is such a wonderful event. Everyone is so lovely. So, I like it here. My name is Tobias. I have the pleasure to lead the design for what we find, so I'm going to talk to you about typography today. But first, I want to talk about Swedish furniture. Why are we talking about Swedish furniture? So, these are two pictures of the front page of the IKEA yearly catalog. And what you see on the left is the layout of the catalog using Futura, which is a typeface from 1927, designed by Paul Renner. And on the right, 1 year later, it did not use Futura by Paul Renner, it used a typeface called Bergana. And this is like a more detailed view of those two typefaces. On the left, Futura, which is, you know, it's a well-recognized typeface. It's on the golden record that we sent with the Voyager spaceship into outer space, amongst other things, and we're done. So why did they do that? So in an interview, a representative from IKEA was saying that they did this so they could remain a consistent presentation online and in print. So why could they not just use Futura when they're online? And that is because back then in 29 and 2010, this was the choice of typography we all had when designing websites. This is what was referred to as the website fonts. It was this group of fonts that was pre-installed on almost all machines. So like, if you use one of these fonts, you could be certain that Microsoft users had that font available on their machine. Macintosh users were. Linux, it came a little bit more blurry, I think. So they really wanted their websites to be seen in the same way as their print material, so they chose Bergana. And because everyone had to stick to those 12 website fonts, this is what a lot of the internet looked like. This is Craigslist from back then. I think it probably still looks the same. But there was a Arial, Bergana. You know, if you wanted to do something creative for Serifs, use Georgia. But of course, you could use other typefaces, right? You could just, like, you know, go into Photoshop, you know, do some typesetting with another typeface, export a picture, and then use that in your design. But that was a really bad idea because, like, a lot of people would see this, which was, like, I think this is from Internet Explorer, the placeholder of, you know, Internet Explorer, and find the image that you wanted to render. And even if a lot of people saw your heading or whatever you said in your image, it was still really terrible for SEO and for assistive technologies and for readability overall and scale. So that was overall a bad idea. So people came up with all these really interesting workarounds to make typography happen on the web. This is called Cipher from the blog post in 2008, which was this really creative technique to use JavaScript to replace the headings in your code while the website was loading with little flat files that had custom typography embedded. So this was really good at the time because, you know, you could still, you know, for SEO reasons, for accessibility, the computer could still see those headings, but it was the kind of bonkers. So then, around the same time, HTML5 and CSS3 took off, right? So, you know, the world moved from layout tables with spacer gifs to using CSS, and like, there was a lot of movement in the web standards world. And CSS3 came with this wonderful new add font feature. And what that meant is that you could finally use font files and embed them in your website. same way that you did with images. So you put the font file on your server, the same as you put your images on your server. And with the font face rule, you told your browser to go fetch that font file from the server. So this was, you know, a huge moment, but it was complicated. This was sort of like the recommended code at the time, because like different browsers expected different font formats, there were like these, you know, these workarounds that we used back in the day. Like if you see the logo, the slide, that was to prevent Internet Explorer to see what's coming after that line because it stopped parsing after that smiley, which it couldn't interpret. So it was still not really easy, right? And in addition to that, like a lot of people were not familiar with how type actually worked on the web because, you know, prior you just used one of those 12 typefaces, you know, you were safe if you're down in Montreal in Georgia. But it turns out, like, these web-safe fonts were also really optimized for the use of computers. Like, Verdun is a very, a lot of work and a lot of effort and a detail went into the creation of Verdun and make it render well on screens. And screens back then had a resolution of, like, 72 or 96 pixels per inch. And these typefaces, when you have really small letters, like you see the outline of an A here with address zones, you know, it's really hard for computers to place those in a meaningful way onto that 72 DPI grid. And that resulted in type looking really bad, unless the type designer, the person who created and designed the typeface, could actually go in, looked at each size of that typeface, and created what's called font hinting, which are instructions for the browser where to place the pixels and which color to use for those pixels. So the appearance of the typeface actually looked like it was intended. And also what people didn't really think about prior is that, you know, like, fonts are designed by people who need to eat, right? Like, you know, it's not like we're done in Arial 3. It's that the operating system providers paid the designers of those fonts for them to be included. And it was, you know, really a thing to just, like, grab everything from the internet and use it. Because, you know, designers need to eat. Things like TypeKit came into existence around that time. TypeKit was this wonderful service where, you know, they negotiated the licenses for the type designers and foundries. They had this API. They had a subscription that you could pay them based on, you know, how much traffic your website got. And it was really easy to use, but it came with, like, a subscription fee. So, in 2009, I also had my interview, my job interview with Google. I was in London back in the day. I was really, you know, I didn't consider myself a designer. I was, like, doing web development, mainly writing HTML and CSS templates for, you know, agencies. And one of the questions that was routinely asked in Google interviews back then was, like, if you worked here, considering the scale of this company, like, what are the things you think, you know, you could do here, what Google should be doing? And me being, you know, like, this web designer, web developer, back then thinking a lot about, you know, CSS3 and HTML5, was like, there should be, you know, font files on Google servers that people can just address here by these data centers, you know, like, why is there not an API? Actually, I don't think I thought about API. I was just like, put those font files on the servers, you know, for people to use. And it turns out they actually hired me back then. So when I actually started with my job as a Google webmaster in 2010, that was the real title, I discovered this typography internal mailing list, right? Typography at google.com. And I remembered this interview question I was still really excited about. So I was like, hey, I don't know who reads this, but, you know, like, we have all these APIs, why can't we not do something for typography? And I got an email back the same day by this software engineer in Mountain View, who worked for the Google Forms team, actually, at the time. It was telling me that this is exactly what they're working on in their 20% time, him and this other software engineer. And how about I join them, you know, and help make it happen? So, I don't know if you're familiar with that concept at Google Day that you spend like 20% of your time on your passion project, like Gmail sort of is a 20% thing, Google Maps too. So I managed to do that. So all of a sudden, it was the like, UX designer for Google Fonts, which we created back then. And I was able to scale it up to 100% until we launched this. So it was called the Google Font Directory Beta. Everything was beta at the time. It had 12 fonts. We differentiated between like the font directory, which was like the page that I created. The software engineers really only cared about the API, so that was extra. And hence, you know, Google Fonts was born. Which made, you know, everything a little easier in terms of code, because you just have to, you know, include that link, you know, then use the font, use Sashi, and then, you know, off you go. And by now, like the software, the fonts in the Google Fonts API have always been open source. By now, they're all in GitHub. You can just go there and download them as well. If you don't want to use the API, then write your own code. So that was 10 years ago. And now I want to invite you to get on my TARDIS. I hope you all have a Dr. Buffy in your mind playing now. I'm going to take a trip in time 10 years forward. Because back then I left the team, you know, like we had launched Google Fonts. There was a version of the one I just showed you. And then I sort of like worked on a few other things. Until like in 2010, I happened to work with the material design team, which is a, you know, a design system team within Google. And Google Fonts was also part of material design at the time, and you know, they were looking for a designer, so I tried them. And that, you know, by that time, you know, you're probably aware like a lot of websites use Google Fonts by now, right? So like there's a lot of access to typography for, you know, people who speak English or, you know, people who use that alphabet. So, you know, what was really left to do? And what's really left to do is to ensure that, you know, everyone everywhere has equal access to all of this, right? So not just, you know, people speaking English using the same 26 characters all the time. There's a lot more writing systems in the world. So this is the new mission that we have, is to ensure open access to communication for everyone everywhere. Actually, there's an additional part, like efficiency, which is a service working fast. Also, 10 years later, going back to, you know, the Swedish furniture house, here's another side-by-side between, like, the 2010 cover of the IKEA catalog and the, I think it's from, yeah, it's from 2020. So, IKEA had also started thinking about, you know, everyone being able to read what they produce. And they had switched the typeface yet again. The separate data is on the left, and what's on the right was the new typeface they were using. Unfortunately, using, you know, the exact size really small. They started using a typeface called Notum. And that was to avoid this. Anyone have any idea what this is? That's right, it's tofu, like you would find in like your miso soup. And tofu is also what a lot of Thai people refer to when they talk about this glyph, which is what computers show what's embedded in every font file. If the computer doesn't have the character to render for the letter you're actually trying to write, and there's no fallback font. So, the way that works is there's a big standards consortium called the Unicode Consortium, and their mission is to create basically a lookup table for every character and every glyph of any language that's used in the world. This is a photo I found on the internet, like a printout of all, like, out of Unicode. It's a very large lookup table. And, you know, each one of those symbols has a Unicode point. So each character in the world is defined by this Unicode point. And when you use your keyboard, you know, what your computer understands actually is, you know, like the Unicode points that you're requesting. And then, you know, it grabs, you know, the font that you told it to use, and then it maps, you know, the right graphical letter to match that Unicode point. And if that font doesn't have it, it falls back to, you know, whatever else is available. And if there's nothing available, it will, you know, render tofu. So, Noto, this typeface that IKEA started to use, is actually called Noto because it's sort of like a word play on no tofu. Noto's mission is to be a typeface that spans all living languages that are included in Unicode. This is just a snapshot, but it covers, I think, 150 writing systems in over 1,000 languages by now. So when Unicode, you know, adds a new language that they review, new editions every year, and then, you know, there's some languages that are not included, they add those, and then, you know, Noto would add those as well. This has been a long-running effort between Adobe and Monotype and Google to make this happen. So that everyone, you know, like, it can be surprising to people who are, you know, like, grown up speaking a language, using an alphabet, that there are regions in the world where there is no typeface, right? There is not just, like, the letter not available in the typeface they've selected, so it falls back to another, there just isn't. And computers would know, you know, what to render. They just don't know. So this huge effort that's been able to cover all living languages, apart from the ones that have just been added this year, and it's available in, like, you know, I'm pretty sure everyone has a phone in their pocket that has something on it. But there are other really exciting, like, you know, coming back to the Google Fonts team, like, with this new mission, I'm not a language expert, I'm not even a type expert, right? I'm a UX designer. I'm learning about all these, like, fascinating new languages, new writing systems, like, they're all connected to cultures and, you know, like, you know, people living somewhere on this planet. And this is a wonderful project by a company called Ektype in India, who had a distributed team in, you know, various regions of India. And India has a lot of languages that are spoken on the subcontinent. It's not just, like, you know, live in India, you speak this one language. There are several languages spoken, and usually there are inconsistent typefaces between the between the languages and writing systems that are being used. So, you know, designers would have to use, like, this typeface for one language and this typeface for another. So this was this effort to, at the same time, sort a typeface across different writing systems and languages to create this consistent font design. And as you can tell, so this is these are examples from Devanagari, Gujarati, Gumuki, where you know, the letter shapes are similar, and you can tell that the design is similar, but the vowel signs, the mantras, are sort of like unique to what people would expect in those languages. Another really great recent project is the Gulzar font. That was created. I should have put my Google glasses on. By a dad who's a professor at the University of Reading, who was born in Iran, and a few other colleagues. And this is a typeface for the Arabic style of Nastaliq, which is used mainly for the Urdu language. What's special about Nastaliq is that it still has a very calligraphic appearance. Arabic on it by itself, the other styles, the more common styles in Arabic, are all still, like, very good in calligraphy. But Nastaliq is especially so. And what's noteworthy here are these cascades where, like, the words start at the top right, and then, you know, the longer the word is, the more letters the word has, the longer the cascade falls to the left. And Arabic has these vowels, sometimes these diacritics, these dots that you see at the top, that change the, you know, the meaning of the letter. And because, you know, those letters all connect, sometimes they can clash. So it's been, like, this very tricky undertaking to make this work using open type technology and actually make those letters come together the way they come together. Because in Arabic also, like, every letter has four different appearances, depending on whether it stands by itself, it stands as, like, the first letter in the word, whether it's in the middle or at the end. It's sort of demonstrated here in this image that I'm showing you as well. Another typeface that I wanted to show you is Questrial. Questrial has been a Latin typeface that's been created quite a while ago, but Questrial was expanded to cover the extended Latin range for the African languages speaking in the sub-Saharan African region. When Africa was colonized by the Europeans, they made everyone use the Latin alphabet. But because the Latin alphabet doesn't really provide all the letters to cater to the sounds that are used in the various languages spoken, people added these additional variations of the letters with these kind of critical marks and these additional strokes and dashes. And there are very few typefaces that include those. And what that resulted in was that people would just swap out the letters that are mapped to the Unicode points, then take a typeface and then modify those, and then tell the computer if you want to type this Unicode point, just render this other letter. Which works fine if you work in print, right? Like you do that once and then you have the text you want, and then you print that and it's fine. But if you do that in a computer environment, everything gets shuffled up because if you switch the typeface, it goes back to what the Unicode point actually stands for, and you just get gibberish. So it was very important to provide typefaces that have those extended character sets, so that people can communicate in virtual environments. There are also projects that cater to readability more. So this is a project by the Braille Institute, which we might know the Braille font, which is for people with no vision, but they also have a typeface for people with low vision that makes sure that letter forms are distinguishable. And a lot of typefaces, the uppercase I and the lowercase L are just like this vertical stroke, which you can't tell apart. And for people with low vision, that can be a real challenge. Same for, P and Q, and, similar to the four devils that we read about yesterday. So these are, these letters will make sure that they're distinguishable from each other, and not, you can't confuse them easily. There are also typefaces that cater to readers suffering from dyslexia. This is a project called Accents that was started by an educator called Bonnie Shaver Troop and a type designer called Thomas Chokin. And this is a variable font that lets you define how wide your letters are supposed to be shown. And this is important for an effect that's, that happens for readers with dyslexia, where the text draws together, or they have a trouble perceiving the letters individually. And this has been shown to help with word perception and recall after reading. There's also an Arabic version of this typeface, and it's called Redex Pro, which is created by Thomas Chokin and Nadine Chen. Another thing that you don't tend to think about is what are the typefaces used in education at schools? So, in a lot of regions, kids still learn to write and read cursive when they start to learn to read and write. And it turns out that the regulations that the education systems and the school systems have across the world are very different. There are very specific rules around what those typefaces are supposed to look like. Unfortunately, there aren't any digital typefaces actually replicating that. So a lot of educators are looking for digital typefaces that match their criteria. And this is, these screenshots are from a project by a typhoon called Type Together, started this huge research project to find out what all the regulations are. They started with the Latin alphabet. So the regulations across the world for school systems using the Latin alphabet, and they're working on this large variable font that can basically be tweaked to replicate all the different typefaces that are expected by the schools, and provide those to the teachers. Okay, time for another time machine ride. We'll take the DeLorean this time. And this time we're going back in time to the 16th century. Because I want to talk to you about the future of typography, and to do so, I want to go back in time and introduce you to this gentleman first. His name is Aldus Manutius. Aldus Manutius was a printer. He owned a print company in Venice in the 15th and 16th century. He's known for quite a few things. He created a But another thing he also did, and he asked his punch cutter, who was called Francesco Griffo, in 1501 to create the first cursive, first Italic typeface to replicate handwriting. And back in the day, when you did something like this, it looked something like this. So if you wanted to do like a new variation of a typeface, you had to actually, you know, create a whole bunch of Latin metal pieces so you could print the typeface. So they had to create a different set of metal pieces for the Italic version, and then they had to create a different set of metal pieces for the different sizes of the Italic version. So this is an example of like the different sizes they would have made all scale to the same proportion. And what you can see here is that the design actually changed a little bit depending on like the size, like the 4 point, which would have been really small, had much bolder strokes, so it was more perceptible. And on the other side, the 72 point would have much thinner strokes because otherwise it would have been perceived as too bold and too fat on large sizes. And each of those, and that's why you get those point sizes that you still find in, you know, word processors today, is because those are the standard sizes that they, you know, for the metal. And you can still see this in, you know, on our computers today. This is a screenshot of the font book in macOS 10, showing the Roboto typeface. You know, and there's a font file for each, like regular italic, thin italic, each combination, and then all that again for condensed. And those are all individual font files that you can install on computers as part of a typeface. And that's still because, you know, all those different like sets of metal from back then. You can still see the same thing replicated in our, you know, text processor software environments. But people have been thinking about this, right? So, like the font files that we're using today, Jerry used the OpenType format. That was agreed upon by Adobe and Microsoft and then everyone else in 1996, I think. So that's the format that everyone's using. And in 2016, Microsoft, Apple, Google, and Adobe extended that format to include the OpenType font variations standard, which is more commonly known as variable fonts. And the variable fonts, finally, all these different variations, like the thin, the condensed, all those, could be put in one font file. So now we have one font file for all of these. I added it this morning because Scott had the same visual yesterday, and I thought it was a lovely idea. This is the recursive typeface, and it's sort of showing the design space for variable fonts, where you can see how like all these different variations and styles are now represented in like one file. So why do all this? Why is this better, right? Like, you know, we've been doing, you know, using type the same way for years, so why do we need it to change? So generally, there are like three types of benefit to it that we talk about. It's compression, finesse, and express. So I'm going to show you what that is about. So the compression is, you know, about file sizes and efficiency. So as soon as you use like two or more of those individual font files, right, if you have like bold and italic with according to you know, regular list three. Usually that's already bigger than the variable font file size. It's just like the one font file. So, you know, efficiency, performance, font size. That's one. That's the compression. There's also finesse, and that's all about making the rendering of your text better, right? Like having better text that's, you know, better quality. So these variable fonts have these different style variations built into them, and that's usually what's called variable axes. And these variable axes are, you know, their spectrum. They usually have like values assigned to them. In this example, like weight ranges from 1 to 1,000. And what's shown in this image is just, you know, an extrapolation between these values, right? Like from 1 very thin to 1,000 very bold. And because, you know, you can use any point on that spectrum, you can now also use like weight value of 233, if that's your favorite number, if it fits your requirements best. So that's weight. That's a very standard works also with, right? So, like in my fun book robotic example earlier, I showed you that there was an extra set of condensed files. So with the width axis as a variable axis, you know, you can just, you know, decide how narrow or how wide you want your type to be. You know, and that's all built into the typeface. So to show you this in action, I'm not going to do, I don't think I'm going to do a live demo. This is a recording. You can see how this is using the robotic typeface. It's like a little demo site that we built, manipulating the weight and the width axes of this variable font. And you can see at the bottom left where, you know, the CSS is shown, there's a new CSS rule called font variation settings. And you just address, you just find the axes that you want to manipulate. And you can basically change that value programmatically. So I'm really excited about this new technology, moving fonts to actually be software, right? Like, previously we were still sort of like attached to these, you know, these legacy concepts that were rooted in, you know, how the metal was created for printing back in the day. And now you can actually, you know, during runtime, do all these things and manipulate your type. Another really nice feature that a lot of variable fonts have is optical size. And if you remember back to that slide earlier where I showed you the different A scale to the same size, showing you how they were designed slightly differently, that was nice when we moved to digital typography. Because digital fonts just like scaled up and down the same design. Like there was one design that was just like scaled up and down. And optical size brings back that ability to optimize the shape of the letter form to the size that the text is used in. So in this example, on the left, you see optical size applied in different sizes, and optical, and, you know, an example of that optical size, where, you know, that large A on the bottom right feels really chunky. And the really nice part about optical size is that, you know, all modern browsers understand optical size and actually apply it automatically. So you don't have to write any CSS if you use a variable font that has optical size built in. Your browser will just, you know, pick the optical size that matches the size of the text it's used to and optimize it. So I just showed you this example with Roboto Serif. Actually, I'm going to switch over here. And then if I find my mouse, it is here. I just wanted to show you, we've got this little demo website. Have you seen this text on the right? We got those same sliders here, which is like the sort of like the common way to represent these axes. You know, I can just manipulate the width here, which is, you know, this width. And the weight. Oh, I can also show you here, you know, like notice how for weight, if you apply weight, it changes the horizontal matrix of your typeface. So, you know, you'll have text reflow if you make it really bold. You know, you might get like more lines of text than you had before. Right? So, there's another feature that's built into the variable fonts, which is great, which lets you change the weight of your typeface without creating reflow. And this is very useful, for example, if you have, you know, text with a hover effect that makes it more bold, and you don't want, you know, your layout to change, you can just use gray to create that hover effect, for example. Whenever you want to avoid reflow, using a bolder style of your typeface, it's going to come in very handy. Let me get back to my slides. Okay, so there's also robotic flex, which is, you know, the version of the classic version of robotic without the serifs. But as a super variable font, and what RobotoFlex has, it doesn't only have like the standard user variable axes, as we call them, like width, weight, slant. It also has what are called parametric axes, which go into a lot more detail in what you can do. For example, there's ascender height. I'm selecting the thing that I want to play. So if you look at these lowercase l's and how tall they are, you can manipulate this. If you look at the descenders, so the G, the lowercase G and the Y, you know, you can manipulate how far they go down. There's grade 2, and that's, you know, there's lowercase. Okay, I'm figuring this out. There's also lowercase I, so if I decrease this, this can be used to kind of make justification on the web better, right? Like, this is sort of like one thing that everyone knows from doing like design: don't justify your text on the web because it will look awful and it will create all these like, you know, empty spots in your text. Using this, you know, justification becomes possible, and you can really improve your layout in your text by, you know, like if you have lines running into each other, you know, you can decrease the length of your descenders, for example, or the height of your AC. Okay, we're down to 9 minutes. We're running a little behind on time. I just want to mention real quick that this is also possible for icons, right? So icons are, you know, fonts. A lot of icons come, icons have come as font these days, so you can build those same features into icon sets. And then optical size, again, is very useful for icons to make them feel less chunky and appropriate to the size. So that was the finesse part, right? Like making text more quality. But the really exciting part is the expression part. So I wanted to show you a few examples of that too. So Tilt is a fairly new typeface that was released that is inspired by these neon signs in like shop doors that say open or close, right, or coffee, which has like all these wonderful axes that gives you a perception of like three-dimensional appearance that you can use and manipulate your runtime. Another very expressive example is Kibana by VectorType. And what they did is, you know, they built these incoming features, like these little strokes and dots into their glyphs, which, you know, are also connected to a variable axis. So if you can manipulate that, you can make those move around. So by animating those, you can, you know, bring this typeface to life in a very, very interesting way. One typeface that I'm personally very excited about is Chantal Sons. On the right here is an artist called Chantal Martin. She's known for her art with like a lot of line drawing and incorporating her own handwriting into her art. And she worked with Aerotype, which is a small type foundry, to turn her handwriting into a variable font. What's special about the variable font is that it has two new axes. One is called Bounce, which, you know, changes up the baseline where those letters sit. Because if you write with your own hand, you don't place the letters on the exact same baseline. So the line on the paper for every letter. So this, you know, just gives it more bounce and makes it look more like an actual person writing it. There's another variable X called imperfection, which slightly changes the appearance of those letters a little bit between those letters, so it looks even more like a human is creating. There's another typeface that was in the media a little bit recently. It was called Climate Crisis. And this is a really interesting typeface. It's sort of conceptual. But it has an axis, a year axis, that goes from 1979 to 2050 and represents the melting of the polar caps from like what they used to be in 1979 to what they are projected to be in 2050 if we don't do anything. So this is a really creative application. To make a statement about the shape of the world using variable font technology. And then another entirely other technology that I haven't mentioned yet is colored fonts. So what you see here is a font called Nala. That is a color font, that was a variable font that makes the animation. But color fonts are like another new standard that W3C has released, which lets type designers include color palettes in their typefaces. So, you know, there have been color fonts before, you know, you might be thinking, but there wasn't a shared standard. Different browsers used different formats, and it wasn't really an agreed upon way to do it. So what these color fonts, these new color V1 color fonts do, is they come with predefined